with us. I will remind us all that we here see the cover of Simon's relatively recent memoir, Slanted, How an Asian American Troublemaker Took on the Supreme Court. And we'll have that available for purchase and signed copies as well at the end. Want to remind everyone and welcome all of you who are participating on Chaz YouTube live stream. Welcome. This will also be recorded and put on our YouTube channel. I have already stressed again that you have the opportunity to buy a copy of Simon's memoir, and if you do so, you get a free CD from the band called The Slants. For those of you who were on campus earlier today, you heard The Slants. As I understand it, it was the first time that version of The Slants had performed together ever. So we had a historical moment earlier today under the bell tower. And before I turn things over to Simon, though, I would like to recognize a couple guests that we have here. We have our Provost and Executive Vice Chancellor, Elizabeth, or Liz Watkins, right here. Thank you, Liz, for joining us. And also, we have a really special guest joined by Pete Mort, Professor Pete Mort, who teaches the Constitutional Law and Moot Court program. But we have the Honorable James D. Ward and his wife, Carol, right here, who played a really important role in the constitutional right to the freedom of the press, one that has a direct connection here to the very building that we're in. We have the Hayes Prize Memorial right outside and talks about some of the very important cases about freedom of the press and press access that went all the way to Supreme Court and Judge Ward, if I believe correctly, in the 1980s. Did I get that right? '82 and '84. So, went on to become an associate justice, and really thank you, Carol, for both of you for joining us today and for joining us in hearing more from Simon Tam. So that being said, last thanks here, of course, to the marketing and the facilities and the events team for the college and everyone here in the University Theater, the technical crew that makes this possible. So without further ado, gonna turn things over to our special guest, Simon Tam.
Cheater. Hey everyone, I'm Simon, this is Joe, and this is my story. Imagine, it's 2004 and I am in a punk club with the band that I actually dropped out of UC Riverside to join, the Stibs. And in this moment, I'm actually about to quit. That's because they forgot about what was most important, the music. But that's okay, because I have an idea for a new band, an Asian American band. This song is about that moment.
2 years and 100 days, all I got is a demo and a beat up pick. Why the hell did I drop out of the school for this? 40 bucks and 40 fights, we spilled up love and never saw our name in life. I'm sick of pleasing everyone.
before you graduate, the idea of starting yet another band, well, your parents probably would not be wild about that either.
You think you're such a punk rock roller, Simon, you are getting older.
I still believe in this rock and roll dream.
10 years from now, we'll be on the center stage to sing for my community. Maybe then you'll see what life has meant to me. It's all about responsibility. You don't care about the music, it's all full of pain. But she never take my dream.
So it didn't exactly go down like that, but oftentimes in theater, they say some things are just emotionally true. Here's how it actually went. I grew up in San Diego, California, grew up in the 1980s, and back then we didn't have the same kinds of representation that we do today. You know, this is way before we had Crazy Rich Asians, Always Be My Maybe, or beef was killing it on theaters and on screens everywhere. Back then, the only kind of representation we had were white actors like Mickey Rooney taping his eyes back and making mock Japanese accents, or characters like Long Duk Dong making these ridiculous stereotypes. And I think that lack of nuance, that lack of people's ability to connect with us as human beings, as real people with in-depth stories, well, that's what led me to getting bullied quite a bit as a kid. There's this one particular moment that always jumps out at me. It's seventh grade, and back then we used to take turns cleaning up the yard after PE while everyone else would go hit the showers. On this particular day, it was my turn, and I thought I was alone out there until I could feel myself being shoved to the ground. I look up, and there's four guys standing over me, but the thing that's most terrifying to me is that they're grinning. They're enjoying that moment, and that's when it begins, just over and over and over again. They throw sand in my eyes, they kick me in the stomach, they hit me in the face, all while yelling two words again and again, Jap and Gook. I'm terrified in this moment, and I don't really know what to do until something in me just snaps. I look at him, and I said, I'm a chink. Like, that's how stupid you are. You can't even be a racist properly. They were so stunned, they turned and walked away. You see, I believe there's power in claiming an identity. There's power in saying, you don't get to define who I am. Only I get to do that. And I think some part of that lesson stuck around as I entered in high school. You see, high school is where I met Kyle, and it's where I fell in love with punk rock. Joe, maybe you can give him some example of, like, you know, something punk. Like, Dolly Parton is, like, kind of like the opposite of punk.
Is it really the opposite of punk? Are you sure about that?
It's a big contrast from, like, you know, punk or punk rock, like leather jackets, attitude.
I'm pretty sure Dolly Parton has a leather jacket.
It's probably like a white leather jacket with a bunch of rhinestones on it, though. Not like, you know, like a motorcycle jacket like in the Ramones.
I'm pretty sure you can ride a motorcycle with a white rhinestone jacket.
And it'd be pretty punk.
Dolly Parton plays acoustic guitar. She plays country.
All right. First of all, I'm pretty sure all these punk kids, you know, these really old R.I.P. some of them. What do they talk about? They call out the man, right? They want to fight the man. Well, you know what 9 to 5 was about? It was literally calling out the man, calling out the patriarchy, the outdated work establishment. Okay. All right. And then you say country is not punk. Well, what about Johnny Cash, Mr. Man in Black? Again, every one of these guys would love to be in his presence, so I'm pretty sure country can be pretty punk rock.
Well, I don't know about that.
Tassel graduation.
But what I can tell you is that growing up, we had a very different idea of what punk was, and it was not always a good thing. This is like years before Hot Topic hit the mall anywhere near my school. So the idea of me having this homemade wallet chain created out of safety pins, like nobody thought this thing was cool. Nobody, except for Kyle. Now who is Kyle? Kyle was like my best friend in high school. We were inseparable. Now one day, Kyle shows up and he's got hot pink hair spiked into Liberty spikes all over the top of his head. And I was like, Kyle, you look so cool. You're so punk. Well, no one else at our school felt that way. All day long, you could see people pointing and laughing. You could hear people whispering under their breath. Teachers were giving them dirty looks. I was supposed to meet Kyle after school on this day, right in the front of our school where the parents come pick up the kids, but I was running a bit behind. By the time I got there, a very familiar scene was unfolding before me. Kyle was now surrounded by like a dozen guys. They're pushing him around and saying horrible things, saying, what are you, some kind of queer or something? What's wrong with you? At one point, one of them says, how come your mom lets you walk out the door looking like that? And at which point, I jump in, I said, hey, maybe it's because his mom's not stupid and ignorant like you. Maybe she doesn't judge people by what's on the outside, but by what's on the inside, because that's what counts. Now, I thought this was an excellent answer. I was like, this is literally true. They did not feel that way. They instead turned their attention towards me. Oh, you want some of this? You want some of this? Come on, Jackie, what do you got? Over and over again, they called me Jackie, and I was like, yo, I'm in classes with some of you guys. You know my name's not Jackie. But that's when one of them says it. Jackie Chan. And all I could think of was, I'm not Jackie Chan. The man is significantly older than me. He's got this bulbous nose that's been busted from doing all those stunts. But more importantly, Jackie Chan knows something that I don't. Martial arts. He could school all these guys in a minute. I took one karate camp session with my cousins back in fifth grade, and they only gave me this white belt with this little yellow stripe on it out of pity. I didn't think it was going to help me out here. But I thought back on that experience in seventh grade, and I thought, well, maybe. So I struck the one karate pose that I could remember. And they're like, whoa, whoa, whoa. Hey, we're just messing with you. Simon, right? We're in classes with you. It was the second time that owning a stereotype actually helped me out in some kind of way. Now, I wish I could say that all of my experiences growing up were like this, that they were met with bravery, a little bit of cleverness and wit. But the reality is that it almost always ended up the same way, with me running away, trying to find a place to hide, and crying because I didn't want to get hit again. 11th grade, I walked up to my dad. I said, Dad, I'm ashamed of being Chinese. And it just broke my parents' heart. But I was tired of getting killed out there. Fast forward a few years later, I am here in the Inland Empire, a couple months away from graduating with a double major at UC Riverside, when I get the call from this band that I'd been working with. Hey, Simon, why don't you drop out, move across the country, and join a punk band? The thing is, I didn't know a whole lot about my new future home.
In the Great Pacific Northwest, there's a place you ought to know. It's kind of like Seattle, but it's way better than Seattle. We got a forest in the city, and bridges on top bridges. Rain or shine, it's a perfect time to make Portland, Oregon a visit.
But doesn't it, like, rain all the time?
Not all the time. You know, it's kind of like April showers, got some May flowers, and then scattered thunderstorms throughout the rest of the year. And also, you'll need like a special UV light for that depression of yours.
That sounds like kind of a lot.
You'll get used to it, or you won't. But I guarantee you that the weather is way better than wherever you're from.
You mean San Diego?
Do you like coffee?
Yeah.
We got the best around. Come on down to Stumptown. It's service with a frown. Our donuts shaped like cock and balls. And vegan bacon made from Mars. Jack Bar record and Zilla Mug. Bar City Mug. A million books. And we like to keep it real. Dr. Pilsen's bags of beer. Naked bike rides Santa Claus. And you won't ever walk down the halls. Recycling bins. Pull out fees. Like it's America's whitest major city. It's a chance for a brand new start. What about that gentrification? We care about sustainability. What about racial diversity? Everybody's in a band. What about that Ku Klux Klan? This is no Confederate flag.
Or people who are Latin, Asian, Native, or Black.
It's a punk rock thing to do.
I guess it would be kind of a badass move.
Change your path, you must approve. Change my path, I better approve. It's a punk rock thing to do. Change my path, I must approve. Change your path, you must approve. It's a punk rock thing to do. It's a punk rock thing to do. To change my path, I must approve. It's a punk rock thing to do. Change my path, I must approve.
So there, in America's whitest major city, I started missing hearing my first few languages. I started missing seeing anyone that looked like me. Started missing the food. And so to deal with a bit of this loneliness and this kind of disconnect from the culture I kind of knew, I started importing all these movies from eBay, like VHS tapes featuring this guy, because let's face it, Jackie Chan is a straight up badass. And about this time, some friends of mine said, "Hey Simon, you like all those Hong Kong action movies? Have you ever seen Kill Bill?" I was like, "I missed it in the theater when I was out on tour, but I did buy it the day that it came out." It's April 2004, and I'm watching this bright yellow disc with these three black lines slide into the DVD player in my apartment. And as the movie kicks off, there's a bunch of action, there's some witty dialogue, but there's this one particular scene where a woman named Oren Ishii begins walking into this restaurant with her gang of crazy 88s. It's the Yakuza, or the Asian mafia that she leads. And in this moment, there's just something in me that feels a bit different. And that's when I realized it's the first time in my whole life that I'd ever seen an American-produced film that showed Asians as cool, confident, and sexy. And I thought, wow, if Hollywood is this bad, the music industry is worse. I had never seen an Asian American on the cover of Rolling Stone, Pitchfork, Spin Magazine, or even on MTV back when they used to play music videos. So that night, I knew something needed to change. That night was when the idea for an Asian American band was born. Now, Band 101, if you want to have a band, you gotta have a name. So I started asking people in America's whitest major city, "Hey, what's something you think all Asian people have in common?" And again, they would say, "Slanted eyes." And I was like, "Slanted eyes? Like, first of all, that's not true. Like, Asian people are not the only people on the planet with any kind of slant to our eyes. And second of all, we're not the only people to own that." But more importantly, I remembered all those experiences getting beat up as a kid. It was these eyes, it was these facial features that got me and beat again and again. I was associated my eyes with shame, with fear, and embarrassment. And because Asians are the most bullied demographic in American schools, I knew that I was not alone in this. But what if we could turn this upside down, flip it around, and move it from feelings of embarrassment and shame to one of empowerment? We could take these stereotypes, these ideas, these words, and throw them back in the faces of our oppressors. I guess you could say that's kind of a punk rock thing to do. Thank you. never really intended this band to be some kind of social political project, but never in my life could I imagine what would come next. We launched this band on myspace.com, which gives you an idea of how old we actually are. And kids from around the country started writing us letters. Thank you. Thank you for giving me a reason to be proud of my heritage. Thank you for showing me that I could be something else. It became this incredible fulfillment, this kind of bringing in of two different halves of myself that I always thought were really separate, my Asian American identity and my passion for music. And so I just knew that whether we liked it or not, we would be judged by our ethnic identities, about who we are, because we were just so few Asian American acts out there. And so we started incorporating lessons of diversity, equity, inclusion. We started taking lessons in counseling and taking courses on it, because we were dealing with kids who were experiencing trauma. And we brought that with us everywhere we went. It was just so incredible. I'll never forget the first time we were on All Things Considered on NPR. In 2008, they broke the story of an Asian American band that was touring and turning stereotypes upside down, all while building a geek army. Now, they called it a geek army because we were also playing anime conventions. Now, we're doing like musical theater storytelling shows at theaters and university level, so I guess it's a different kind of geek army. It was incredibly fulfilling, but everything started falling apart, as it sometimes will, when I became friends with an attorney. Spencer Trowbridge, this IP attorney, says, hey, Simon, you're touring, you're hitting the radio stations, you're making headlines. Have you ever thought about applying to register for your trademark? And I'm like, well, that sounds kind of expensive, Spencer. But he assures me it's only a few hundred dollars. And he says, in like 6 months, this will all be over. You won't even have to think about this again. So I said, okay. I mean, it sounded like the right thing to do, especially because bands need trademarks. You need to be able to protect your IP rights if you want to be able to get things like record label deals or work with sync licensing agencies and that sort of thing. So I said, okay, let's just go ahead and do it. This was late 2009. Well, a few months later, Spencer calls me up and he says, hey, Simon, we got a problem with your application. I'm like, well, what is it? He says, the government is denying your application because they said the name of your band is disparaging to persons of Asian descent. And so I was like, wait, does disparaging mean what I think it means? Are they saying we're racist to Asian people? And he says, yes. I'm like, I didn't even know there was a law against this. Like, what does it actually say? And that's when he reads me Section 2A of the Lanham Act, which says that you cannot register trademarks that are considered scandalous, immoral, or disparaging. And in this case, they said that we were disparaging. But it's not just like what anyone thinks of as disparaging. They have to find what's called a substantial composite of the reference group. So in this case, a whole lot of Asian people have to be disparaged by it in order for them to deny us this right. So I'm like, okay, we just spent the last couple years touring all across North America, playing at the biggest Asian American festivals in the continent. Like, who did they find who were, you know, who's actually upset by our name, who felt disparaged? And that's when he said, nobody. I'm like, what do you mean nobody? Like, you said a substantial composite. Nobody's like, no composite. He says, no, nobody. But they did, they quoted urbandictionary.com, and they used photos of Miley Cyrus pulling her eyes back in a slant eye gesture. I'm like, you're telling me that the federal government, with all of its power, all of its resources, is using wiki joke websites to deny me my rights? He says, yeah, yeah, but I think they're just wrong on it. And I think if we just tell them and show them how your community is supporting the band, I think we can win. He says, I think we should absolutely fight back.
Don't let the rest this way. Don't let the text prevail. Don't let the weakness of others infect your health. Don't be their alibi. Don't come back, don't cut back. Just leave that to haunt my main attack. Do the never not retract.
want you to think about this for a second. How would you prove that you're not offensive to yourself? Like, think about it. Like, what kind of evidence would you bring to the table to prove this? In our case, we turn to our community. Executive directors from numerous Asian American social justice organizations around the country wrote letters in our support saying the Slants do not disparage, they celebrate Asian identity. On top of that, we demonstrated how every single Asian American newspaper, radio station, and television show all supported our use of the name. And on top of that, we got one of the most preeminent linguistics experts in the country, Dr. Ronald Butters, to write this huge report over the history of the term, showing how even in the height of its use in the 30s and 40s, it actually wasn't all that offensive, but more importantly, how since the 1960s and 70s, Asian Americans were using this term in a reappropriated, self-empowering kind of way. And we got two independent national surveys conducted that showed 92 to 98% of Asian Americans supported our use of the name. It was actually the biggest appeal in US history under this law. We sent all this in, thousands and thousands of pages of evidence, and the government said, it's not good enough. It's not good enough because Urban Dictionary says so. With a few keystrokes, they wiped away the voices of thousands of Asian Americans. And so then we started to shift the conversation, changed it altogether. Instead of asking if we are offensive, we said, well, why? Why do you think this band is offensive? Like, what's different about the Slants from the hundreds and hundreds of trademarks out there for Slant, like Slant Shack, Slanted Records, Slant No Rant, et cetera? What was different about the Slants? And they came back and they said, it's because you are too Asian. I'm like, what do you mean? Their exact words were that it is incontestable that the term Slants is of those of Asian descent by how we use the mark as the name of an Asian American band. In other words, they said, if you go to theslants.com, you see tons of Asian people on there. I'm like, yeah, that's my band. But in their minds, if you looked at us and you saw the words The Slants, you would not be able to help but think the obscure racial slur instead of any other definition in the dictionary. But that's just a more convoluted way of saying anyone can register The Slants as long as they're not Asian. And the problem is that if you were to actually chart out their logic, it would look something like this. Like, the more Asian we became by adding band members or using artwork from our respective cultural heritages, the more disparaging we became because it was more of an association with our identity. And the thing is, we were not just a band with a couple of Asian dudes in it. The problem was, like, our band was like super duper Asian. You gotta remember, we wrote songs about Asian American identity. We toured and played Asian American festivals and anime conventions. It was built into everything that we were doing. And the problem was, it just made us far too Asian for the government. This, of course, brought me a whole lot of frustration. But perhaps the biggest frustration of this journey, especially at this point in the story, is that all along, I couldn't actually speak for myself. I was not the lead singer of the band, thankfully. And in the court of law, I could not speak for myself. I had to rely on an attorney to basically give voice to my own feelings, to have an advocate, so to speak. And then I just thought about all the other people out there trying to put their voice forward. People who needed an advocate themselves, but who is speaking for them?
Thank you.
Now along this journey, I kept thinking that we didn't have a lot of power. That when you're up against an entity like the U.S. government, one can oftentimes feel powerless. That you don't have a lot of options. I didn't even have a lot of resources. Even though the law firm agreed to take the case on pro bono, I was still responsible for the legal fees. Now, I didn't really know what that meant until I got my first bill for something called appellate printing for several thousand dollars. One of many to come. And so I felt like I didn't have any other choice, that I needed to go back, because I was like, it should be up to us. It should be up to our community, not up to the government to decide what's best for ourselves. And so we decided to use the little bit of power we did have, our art, our music. And so we actually wrote an album, and we dedicated that album to the U.S. Patent and Trademark Office. We called it The Band Who Must Not Be Named. And we actually kick off the album with an open letter to the Trademark Office. But throughout this journey, this has been, at this point, 6 years, we just keep fighting and fighting and trying to find a way in, trying to appeal, saying like, you know, you can't use somebody's race against them. All those arguments fail. They just flop. It wasn't until we actually get to something called the Federal Circuit, which is right across the street from the White House. At that point, one of my attorneys is actually sick. He's gone, he's MIA, not responding to anything, and so the junior associate, his assistant basically, ends up writing the brief, which if I'm, you know, I was the pro bono guy, so he was probably doing all the work anyway. But he says, Simon, you know, as a trademark guy, you don't get to write a lot of constitutional arguments. I'm just gonna throw some in here, just in case it ever goes up, but it totally won't, but we're just gonna put it in here. And so he says, maybe this violates due process, and maybe it violates my First Amendment rights. There at that court, they actually don't care about any of the other evidence out there. They don't care about any of the arguments. They just said, we just want to hear, does it actually violate the First Amendment? And we argued, yeah, we think it does. But we lose unanimously. And then 5 days later, we get something else from the court. It's called a sua sponte, order to vacate. They want us to basically say, forget that opinion ever existed. We want you to come back in, and we want you to argue this case en banc with all federal judges up in here sitting on this thing. But we only want you to talk about one thing. Does Section 2A of the Lanham Act actually violate the First Amendment? And so we come back, and we say, yeah, we think it does. And that time, 9 out of 12 federal judges agree with us, striking the law down as unconstitutional. Our first bit of victory in this whole process. But then 6 months later, I get another notice. It's the Trademark Office, now with their new BFFs, the Department of Justice, who decided to file suit and drag me here. You know, the final boss stage of this whole legal adventure. And as I mentioned, we're so frustrated. So as we were rolling up on the Supreme Court, we do release the band Who Must Not Be Named. We dedicate it to the U.S. Patent and Trademark Office. And as I mentioned, it starts off with a song called From the Heart. And you know, if you've ever felt powerless before, if you have ever felt invisible, then you know what it feels like, at least a little bit in this process. And so we want to invite you to be a part of it. You can sing along with just one word, and that's no. So when we point at you, all you got to do is yell out the word no. Let's try it. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. All right, you already know the song.
Thank you. won't remain silent. It's a defining moment. We sing from the heart. We sing from the heart. And we won't be complacent. It's a rock and roll nation. We sing from the heart. Yeah, we sing from the heart. Heart.
Good job, thank you.
Now, much to the chagrin of my attorneys, we did play the song on the steps of the Supreme Court. That's the punk rock thing to do, right? But it's okay, because this was actually a federal holiday, and they kind of changed the rules a little bit on those days. It was Martin Luther King Jr. Day. That was the day we decided to release our album. And we did actually celebrated by taking our guitars and walking over to the MLK Memorial. Now, this place is actually my favorite place in Washington, D.C., especially at night. You see, they have collections of Dr. King's words carved into stone all around. It's lit up. It's so powerful and inspiring. I'll never forget as my eyes laid upon my favorite quote of all from Dr. King. It says that the moral arc of the universe is long, but it bends towards justice. And I remember thinking, staring at those words and thinking, that's true, but that moral arc, it does not bend on its own. It requires patience, it requires persistence, and it requires people willing to fight for their rights. At this point in the journey, I had spent almost 8 years in a legal battle and actually ended up losing every one of my original bandmates. I was now the only guy left. And while the new band was supportive of the general effort, they just didn't have the same kind of memories as I did back when we were scrappy and just kind of struggling and trying to figure out what to do. The night before we were due at the Supreme Court, we're actually eating at a Chinese restaurant in Chinatown, being interviewed by a journalist from China. And at the end of the meal, we're given these fortune cookies. And I never really thought a whole lot about them. I mean, I grew up in a Chinese restaurant, and I always just thought they were kind of like this, these kind of gimmicky kind of things. But that night, as I cracked open the cookie and I pulled out the slip of paper inside, I mean, I thought, well, maybe there's something to this after all. It's early the next morning when we hail a car and we pull up here to this building. This building with its giant Roman columns in front, as if it's preparing for gladiator-like combat. This building actually has four words inscribed into it. It says, equal justice under law. I remember looking at those words and I thinking, I hope that's true today. I hope that's true, because almost every other time that our community came up before this court, before this governing body, we didn't receive things that looked like justice to us, because it was the same government that said it was okay to ban people from China, including members of my own family, treating us more like vermin than human beings. The same governing body that said it was okay to lock up American citizens and put them into concentration camps, all in the name of safety. Justice, not sure about that today. But we get ushered in. We kind of use the side entrance like we got TSA pre-check in this thing or something. And they let us in the courtroom. Now, they give us our seats, but we're not actually sitting anywhere near my attorneys. You see, they're arguing from two tables up front, right under this raised dais where the justices will come out. And behind them are rows and rows of padded chairs. That's reserved for members of the court or the attorneys that paid extra for the good seats. Behind them are these hard wooden pews. There, in the second row, center of those pews, were seated. As they let everyone else in, you could feel the room change. People saw these Asian guys in suits up front, and you could feel the fingers being pointed behind us. You could hear the whispering. Is that the band? At one point, someone does ask, are you in the Slants? And I said, yeah. And I introduced myself, and then they get up, and they start waving. They call the court marshal all over. Say, hey, this is Tam of the court case being argued before the Supreme Court today. Doesn't he at least get to sit in the front row of this section? And the court marshal looks at me and he says, well, I have to check with the Solicitor General first. And of course, I'm like, that's the dude we're arguing against today. He leaves, and about 10 minutes later, he comes back, and he looks at me, and he says, I'm sorry, Mr. Tam, but we're saving this seat in case someone important shows up today. I'm like, yo, why you gotta cut me so deep like that? But honestly, that's how it felt like this entire journey. It doesn't matter, though, because the gavel strikes, and then the men and women in black robes begin entering the room. Now, a lot of people ask me, like, what's it like? What's it like being in that courtroom, especially with your name on the docket? And I gotta say, it's actually really weird. You see, you have all these Supreme Court justices. You have one of the highest attorneys in the country all talking about me, talking about my band. But the person they're talking about is someone that I didn't connect with at all. They're talking about someone who's doing something offensive, someone who's hurting their community. And all I could think of was, you don't know me. You don't know me. Like, you weren't there when we decided to dedicate all the profits from our album to fund research as to find out why Asian American women experience cancer rates 8 times higher than anybody else. You weren't there as we launched into anti-bullying campaigns. You certainly weren't there as I was talking to those kids, telling them not to take their own lives, because things would get better. That, as somebody who was also physically assaulted as a child, that I knew that things do get better. You don't know me. You don't deserve to use my name or the name of my band. But of course, I can't say anything. This is the irony of the whole situation. I am in America's highest court fighting for freedom of speech. But in that room, I can't say a damn thing. So how it actually feels is invisible, insignificant, like it didn't even matter. I'm sitting there feeling dejected in the most deep kind of way. But about halfway through the arguments, this little voice pops up.
Does it not count at all that everyone knows that the Slants is using this term not at all to disparage, but simply to describe, to take the sting out of the word?
And I was like, notorious RBG. She gets it. I think I'm in love with the Supreme Court justice. And the only thing that the government could say in response is, well, we found a lot of articles on the internet that suggested otherwise, and I wanted to get up and say, no, no, you're talking about UrbanDictionary.com. You're not talking about my community. But of course, I can't say anything. 55 minutes pass, and the whole thing is over. We're picking up our stuff out of the lockers, getting ready to leave the court, and I'm just thinking, I don't know if they get it. I don't know. And as we walk out the doors and we start descending the steps outside the courtroom, I look out, and the plaza that is in front of the Supreme Court is filled with people, like maybe a couple hundred people down there. And I'm thinking, they don't get it. Like, court's in session today, there's no tours. But as we're walking down, we're halfway down the steps when the crowd looks up. They see us, and they begin erupting in applause, cheering for us as we walk down. I was like, I don't get it. And as we hit those final steps, these two Asian kids run up to me. Simon, our parents let us ditch school to be here today. And I was like, yo, what kind of Asian parents do you have? And they're like, no, you don't get it. We're from California. We're freshmen in high school. So for our whole lives, we heard about the one who's willing to fight for the dignity of our community. We wanted to be in that courtroom, but there were just too many people. We couldn't get in. But we wanted to find you, to meet you, and to tell you that, you know, when we graduate, we're going to study public policy development in college. And when we finish there, we're going to run for office, and we're going to change the system that you've been fighting against. And I remember thinking, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if we win or lose in that courtroom, because we won where it mattered the most, in the hearts and the minds of the people most affected by the laws, those kids saw what I couldn't, even though I spent almost a decade fighting this thing, that it was about transforming the very systems that were there, about shifting power, about bringing dignity to other people. And so, I'm supposed to meet my attorneys in the corner in this whole thing where a little media circus had gathered, and that's where we step over to meet them. And my attorneys are just standing there. Everyone's waiting, like the reporters. See, what they're doing is they're actually waiting for a statement, an official statement from the attorneys. Well, the thing is, I used this like tiny law firm out of Hackensack, New Jersey, who had never even been to the Supreme Court before. Like, we caught them taking selfies up in there. So they didn't prepare a statement. So they look at me and they're like, well, Simon, do you want to say something? And I was like, absolutely. Because I wanted to say all the things that no one was willing to say in the courtroom. I said, if the government truly cared about fighting against racism while using trademark law to do so, why didn't they begin by canceling the registrations of the KKK or Stormfront or actual hate groups? Why did they choose to wage this battle against an anti-racist band? Maybe it's because they don't actually care. Maybe it's because they want to use so-called bad language to distract us from bad policy. You see, I called it bad policy because we were not the only ones who are too Asian or too whatever. Think about it. Who are the kinds of people that reappropriate language? Women, people of color, and members of the LGBTQ community. And it turns out that in almost every instance, those were the only times the government upheld the law and used it to suppress our speech. That when it came to everyone else, they give them the benefit of the doubt. That's why every single slur you could think of for an Asian person was registered hundreds, if not thousands of times, except in cases when Asian people applied. I said all this, I shared it all, but almost nobody picked it up on the news that night. We decided to keep going. Because, like those kids that I encountered, they knew. They knew what mattered most. And so we just kept touring. We kept sharing our story, hoping that it would reach the ears of the law clerks at the Supreme Court, that they would hear our story and take that into consideration as well. Six months later, it is, of all days, June 19th, Juneteenth. My phone is blown up. It's got over 700 missed notifications at 6 a.m. So I'm like, I think something happened. I hop on Twitter to look up OPB, Oregon Public Broadcasting, the very first NPR affiliate that broke the story of this Asian band that was turning stereotypes upside down. They write with a single tweet, "The Supreme Court rules in favor of the Slants." And later that day, well, yo, I found out that decision was unanimous.
Some days you'll take what you can get. Some days you'll want to do again. Some days it's best to not regret. Just stay the same. We like watching the replays.
our case, we decided to retire. I was just tired. The miles were long, the nights. At this point in the journey, spending over 13 years of my life touring, hustling, trying to make things work, and 8 of those years stuck in a legal battle. But we also wanted to pivot and shift gears and focus on creating change, changing the systems. And so, the Slants Foundation was born, a nonprofit organization that's dedicated to empowering folks of color, teaching them by mentoring them and funding their works to forge arts and activism together in civic engagement and redefining what is possible with art. You know, all along I thought that I wanted to be a rock star, I thought I wanted to play music, but then I started realizing it's really about expression, it's about changing hearts and minds, and through this nonprofit, I finally was able to do that. And I guess maybe all along, that was what I was looking for. That was the new punk rock.
Working 9 to 5, what a way to make a living. We're just getting by, it's all taking and no giving. They just use your mind, never give your credit. It's enough to drive you crazy if you let it.
Yeah, I guess that's punk enough. And so, punk rock, speaking out to the man, using your voice to flip stereotypes, turn systems upside down. And I think that's perhaps the most important part of that journey. Originally we thought it was going to be our last show in 2019. It turns out we had another show today. But so things sometimes change. Sometimes you have a reimagined future that you don't even know is possible yet. But all along, if you just stick to your guns, stick to your values, and inject and bring passion in wherever you go, I think that's where you can really find out what and who you're actually meant to be.
I can see it all so clearly. On the road to stop and hear me.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Simon. Oops, I don't know if this is on. I want to thank you. Can you hear me? Enough? Yes? I want to thank you for sharing some of your life stories here, some of your music, some of your art. Coming back to UCR. This is you gave a TED talk here.
In 2015, in this very room.
In this very room. All right, and before that, and then back in 2002 or 3.
Yeah.
So we do have a gift for you, but before we give you the gift, I just want to remind you that you're always a Highlander. and really proud of the work that you've been able to share with us, that you've done. We hope that UCR animated some of that. And show some of our gratitude from UCR. Jeff will bring this out. I don't even know what it is, so we're going to find out together.